I am Dr. Nalini Avinash Vagmare, working as assistant professor in Tilak Maharashtra Vidyapeeth Pune. This is my brief information. Today's our topic is a brief political history of ancient India. Major and minor dynasties, both we have to study in this topic. A historical period and important dynasties which are existing at the time are Mauryan dynasty, Satavahanas, Kushanas, Gupta dynasty, Vakatakas, Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas, Pandavas, Cholas, Shilaharas, Yadavas. Many other dynasties are there, but briefly we have to study here these dynasties. Then sources of Mauryan dynasty, which is the biggest and first dynasty in India. No source, no history as mentioned. So to understand the Mauryan dynasty at that time, the Puranas, the Buddhist and Jain texts, the account of Herodotus, Megasthenes, the Arthashastra of Kautilya, the Mudra Rakshasa of Vishakadatta, these are the some written sources which give detailed information about the Mauryan rulers, their administrative system and political extension of that period. Then some archaeological sources like rock inscriptions as well as stupas of Emperor Ashoka are primary source of knowing the history and administration of the Mauryas. Then Mauryan dynasty. During the 4th century BC, the Maurya established one of the most extensive and well-governed empire in India. Chandragupta Maurya was the founder of the or the ruler of this dynasty, one of the greatest emperor of India. His administration was successful not only in maintaining the unity, security and peace of the empire, but also in creating a state, what we call a welfare state nowadays. Therefore, Chandragupta has been regarded as one of the greatest empire builder and administrator of India. Then after Chandragupta, Bindusara, who succeeded his father Chandragupta, did not attempt to extend the territories of his empire. However, the kingdom of Khasas in the northwest frontier was conquered by his son Ashoka during his reign. Ashoka's son and successor of Bindusara attacked the state of Kalinga, which lay between the rivers Mahanadi and Godavari on the southeast coast of India, and conquered it after hard fighting. That was the only conquest of Ashoka because he accepted Buddhism after it and left fighting wars of conquest. So after this Kalinga war, which was took place in 261 BC, Ashoka adopted the Dharma Maha Pravachana rules and he given up the fighting after this Kalinga war. Then he ever kept the territory of empire intact and ruled over a vast territory which extended from Kashmir in the north to the south, excluding the kingdoms of Cholas and the Pandyas, and from the borders of Persia in the north, west to Bengal in the east. Then Ashoka's Dhamma. After the Kalinga war, Ashoka adopted the Buddhism and he propagated that one. While we are studying the Ashoka's life sketch, it is very necessary to understand the what is the Ashoka's Dhamma. Dharma is the Prakrit form of Sanskrit word dharma. Ashoka's ideal in propagation of his dharma was more ethical and social than religious. His own private belief, which were quite liberal, the circumstances of his age, which pointed out the necessity of religious toleration among his subjects, and the political necessity of holding a big empire intact, which consists of people divided on geographical and cultural basis, were responsible for his policy of Dhamma Vair. Let's see what is his Dhamma. The essential feature of Dhamma Vair, it emphasizes certain moral practices like respect to elders, liberality to dependents, etc., which all had their roots in family life of individuals. It advises people to observe compassion, kindness, liberalism, truthfulness, purity, and non-violence to all men and animals. Convert personal virtues into social virtues, and into social virtues develop reverence to all religious sects, and leave ritualism and all sinful passions like anger, pride, enmities, etc. Thus, the Dhamma of Ashoka was a practical code of conduct of social ethics, which formed the basis of religions, and its primary distinction was social responsibility, means everyone has to do his own duties first. and give respect to elders, love to youngers, and look after the needy and poor people. Then for the propagation of this dharma, Ashoka got engraved his message on various stone pillars and rocks, categorized into 14 rock edicts, minor rock edicts, 7 pillar edicts, other edicts practiced in his personal life, all that he meant to propagate, guided his public behavior according to Dhamma and undertook Dhamma Vijay Yatras, appointed Dhamma Mahamatras who propagated this Dhamma all over India and abroad also, and held the third Buddhist council at Pataliputra, which deputed missionaries including Ashoka's son and daughter to distant foreign countries. Ashoka's policy succeeded only during his lifetime but failed to bring permanent fruitful result. Then after Ashoka, after the fall of Maurya, some other foreign invasion on India, under that the Greeks, the Sakas, the Parthians, the Pallavas and the Kushanas entered India and made it their homeland and were completely Indianized this themselves in India. Then what's the Mauryan contribution to Indian culture? In the Mauryan period, the literature was flourished. Like we take the example of Mudra Rakshasa, Vishakhadasya, Kautilya, Arthashastra. Then trade and commerce with foreign countries along with Ashoka's Dhamma, Buddhism, at that time, trade and commerce also flourished at that time. And Mauryan art is also popularized at that time. Ashoka's pillars, which give us a lot of information to us today about that period, Ashoka's time, administration, as well as people welfare things, all things, these pillars also attract to tourists, all over the tourists to India from that time to till today. And Ashoka also, at that time we find Jainism, Buddhism, Hinduism also exist at that time. And it was the first big dynasty in India. One of the first big dynasty, the Mauryan dynasty in India in ancient time. Then after another dynasty in ancient India is the, after the Mauryas, the first ruler of after the Mauryan, the Gupta dynasty is one of the big and famous dynasty in India after Mauryas. The first ruler of Guptas is Sri Gupta, who was the founder of this Gupta dynasty, and his successor Ghatashchaka were of no significance and ruled over a petty kingdom. The foundation of the greatness of family was laid by its third ruler, Chandragupta I, who ruled between 329 to 340. Samudragupta proved to be a military genius, a great conqueror, and almost successful commander who remained undefeated throughout his life, and that is why V.A. Smith called him as a Indian Napoleon. We know the Napoleon in Europe, but Indian Napoleon called by only this person, that is Samudragupta, because he was a very good commander in army and conquered so many territories at that time. Then Samudragupta, by his successful military campaigns, built up a vast empire and created an area of influence over the larger part of our northern India and subcontinent. He performed one or more than Ashwamedha Yagnas. Three types of his coins represent him in a military soldier. Samudragupta possessed not only a powerful army but also a strong navy at that time. Then he restored the prestige of Brahmanic religion but was tolerant to all other religions. Means along with patronized the Vaishnavism or Brahmanic religion, he also patronized the Shaivism, Buddhism and Jainism also. Then thus the age of Samudragupta was an age of progress in almost all fields, a process in which he himself participated, and the golden age of ancient India, Gupta period, began with this period. So that's why while we study the ancient India history, which period we called as a golden age period, that time we find that the Gupta period is called as a golden age, under that the Samudragupta period. Then after the Skanda Gupta was the last great Gupta ruler, and the empire began to disintegrate during the rule of his successors. Causes of downfall of Gupta dynasty. Such a big dynasty, what are the causes to failover of or downfall of this dynasty? internally the incompetent rulers means after Skandagupta there was no a strong ruler. It's one reason to downfall of this dynasty. Then second, the provisional governors participate in disintegration and fall of the empire and beyond its frontiers. Means those who are appointed as a provisional administrator, they themselves mutually not cooperated, and they tried. There is also one more reason to downfall of this dynasty. Then successful attack of Vakataktas from the south and the Hunas from the northwest contributed to downfall of this Gupta dynasty. Then what's the Gupta's contribution to Indian culture and literature? The transformation of the ancient Brahmanical faith into something like modern Hinduism is one contribution. Second, its final triumph against Buddhism and Jainism, its spirit of liberalism, its abortion, absorption of foreigners within its fold, and practice of tolerance by every religion are regarded as the distinguishing feature of the religious life of the Gupta age. The Gupta rulers largely participate in all these changes, provided protection to Bhagavata sect of Hinduism, performed the Ashwamedha sacrifices, gave donation to Brahmanas, and built many temples. Many art and architecture temples are the example of that period still existing in India till today. Then Puranas and Sutras were written at this time. Even Mahabharata was given a new shape at this time. Bhakti Marga became the popular cult this time, and attractive features of Buddhism and Jainism were accepted by the Hinduism this time also. The theory of 10 avatars Vishnu was accepted this time. Shaivism also became popular and came closer to Bhagavatism. Different other gods and goddesses, yakshas, gandharvas, plants, rivers, mountains were rivers. Cities like Banaras, Allahabad became places of pilgrimages this time. And all those features which were found in modern Hinduism were perfected during the Gupta periods. Means the Gupta periods, they contributed to literature, culture, traditionally, socially also. Foreigners were accepted within Hinduism. It was thus revival of Hinduism and became the prominent religion of India at that time. Then Buddhism, though on decline, was very much popular in many parts of India, and great Buddhist scholars like Astaga, Vasubandhu and Diganga flourished during the time, this time. Jainism was also quite popular. Efforts were made to strengthen it, and two Jaina councils were held at Mathura and Vallabhi respectively. The followers of different faiths held religious discourses with each other, yet there was no religious animosity found in this time. The construction of temples began during the Gupta age. This time also epics, the Ramayana, Mahabharata, Puranas, Smritis were either written or completed. On commentary on Yoga Sutra of Patanjali, the Kama Sutra of Vatsyayana, the Panchatantra, the Hitopadesha were written in this time also. The Buddhist scholars like Asanga, Vasubandhu, Dignanga, Dharmapala, and Jaina scholars Siddhasena, Bhadrabahu II, Umasmati flourished during this time. Texts were written in Pali, Prakrit, Tamil languages, and many texts of Sanskrit were also translated in this time also. Among secular literature, Vasavadatta by Subandhu, Ravana Vada by Bhatt, the Mudra Rakshasa by Sudraka, Amar Kosha by Amar Singh, etc. occupy a prominent place in this time. Besides, Kalidasa wrote several books like the Meghaduta, Raghuvamsa, Kumara Sambhava, Abhijana Shakuntalam, etc. Therefore, has been regarded as the sixth era of Sanskrit language. I mean, Kalidasa was existing in Gupta period. He wrote world famous poetry and books at that time. Then science, grammar, astrology, medicine, etc. all made tremendous progress. Scholars like Aryabhatta, Vahramihira, Nagarjuna, Dhanavantri, etc. work in these different fields in this time. Then one of the famous university exists in this time. The Nalanda University was the most important university of India. It was the Oxford of Mahayanism and revival of Kashi. It was founded in the 5th century AD by one of the later Gupta emperors. In the course of time, it became a truly international center of learning. How today the various universities in all over India, in ancient time, Takshashila, Nalanda University was very famous, and foreigners visited to came to India to understand the Buddhism and other religion. So it is one of the world famous university at that time. The university had imposing buildings. There were 8 colleges built by different patrons. Those colleges were built in rows. The whole of university area was enclosed by a brick wall. The universities had various kinds of facilities were provided to students for their studies. There were 3 great libraries. There were more than 10,000 students, including teachers of all kinds. They came from practically all parts of Buddhist world. The names of some of the most famous teachers of Nalanda University were Silabhadra, Vasubandhu, Dharmapala, Chandragupta, Jnanachandra, etc. So the history of Nalanda University is in a way the history of the extension of Buddhism in India. Then while we are in the last few hours, we are studying the North Indian 2 dynasties, Mauryas and Gupta dynasties. So we have to also cover the South Indian dynasty. Under that briefly we have to study the Deccan South Indian dynasty, under that the Shatavahanas. After the decline of the Mauryas, many small kingdoms sprang into exist, which were originally principalities of the Mauryas. The Satavahanas, who were the first to establish a powerful empire in the history of Karnataka in particular, and that of Deccan in general, were also originally the feudatories of the Mauryas. They established a vast empire which extended up to Sanchi in the north, Konkan in the south, and the sea in the west and east. The Satavahanas were the first remarkable Deccan power to establish their mastery over northern India and to bring about an integration between north and south India. Then the original home of the Satavahanas is, according to some scholars, says as Maharashtra, some says Andhra Pradesh. So generally they are known as Andhra Satavahana rulers. Simuka was the founder of the Satavahana dynasty. Krishna extended kingdom up to the Nasik. Sri Satakarni was the great ruler. His queen Nayanika belonged to Maratha family. Nangat inscription explain about him. Then Gautami Putra Satakarni, he defeated Yadava, Sakas, Pallava, saved the Deccan from the foreign occupation. Then Sri Yajna Satakarni was the last great king of Satavahanas. Paithan was the capital of this Satavahanas. Then what's the contribution of the Satavahanas to Indian culture and literature? The Buddhist stupa at Amaravati is one of the marvel of the Satavahana art. Some of the caves at Bhaja near Pune belong to the Hinayana sect. The famous stupa at Karle near Pune was also the gift of the citizens of Vajayanti and Soparam. The Satavahana king went the followers of Vedic religion, perform Vedic sacrifices. Then they also built so many viharas. Satavahana monarchs also gave wholehearted encouragement to Buddhism. They made generous donation to Buddhist Sangha and constructed, maintained viharas and chaitas. The Buddhist monastery at Pitalkora, Kolhapur, Amaravati, many other places indicate that Buddhism also commanded a large following. Some Satavahana queens seem to have been followers of Buddhism, though the kings were followers of Vedic religion. The Cholas. Another South Indian dynasty is the Chola. The Chola kingdom was a very ancient one. There is a reference of the Cholas in the Mahabharata. They are also mentioned in the account of Megasthenes, the inscription of Ashoka. The Mahavamsa referred to the relation between Cholas and the rulers of Ceylon. Potlomi also refers to the Cholas. Sangam literature refers to many Chola princes who were models of justice. Then so many inscriptions also give us a lot of information about the Chola dynasty. Then some monuments also give us a lot of information about the Cholas. Under that, their temples also give us information about Cholas. Then the literature, Sangam literature, Arab travelers, Muslim historians, early European travelers like Marco Polo give us interesting information about South India and Chola dynasty. Then Karikala, the Chola gain in territory and influence in the reign of Karikala, who ruled in 2nd century BC AD. Then Vijayalaya, Rajaraja the Great was the famous ruler of this Chola dynasty. Then what's their contribution? They are good administration, maritime, commerce, and naval activities done by these Chola rulers in India and in other parts of the world. Then the Chola literature made a lot of progress during the Chola period. And Nambi and Ramanuja are the reformers of at that time. Then Chola art, very Chola developed the Dravidian style and almost perfect in India. The Cholas were great builders and they executed works on stupendous scale. Chola cities have elaborate plan and laid out. The centers of city was temple. So many temples give a lot of information about this Cholas art and architecture. Bradeshwara temple, also known as Rajarajeshwara temple after its royal builder. The Tanjore temple, also one of the example which the Chola ruler patronized it and built it. It's one temple which attract the tourists also today. Subramanya temple in the city also. Aranyeshwara temple at Darasuram and the Tirumbaneshwara temple at Tirumbam, both attract which are in Tanjore district, built by the Chola rulers. Then these are the references I refer for this lecture. So here we have studied in this lecture the two North Indian dynasties, Mauryan dynasty and Gupta dynasty, and the two South Indian dynasties, Satavahanas and Chola dynasties. So here I refer this book, A.L. Bhasham book, Cultural History of India, New Delhi, 1971. D.N. Shah book, History of Ancient India, Manohar Publication, New Delhi, 1998. V.D. Mahajan, Ancient India, Chand and Company, Delhi, 1960. R.S. Sharma's book, Aspects of Political Ideas and Institution in Ancient India, Motilal Banaras Publication, New Delhi, 1959. Upinder Singh, A History of Ancient India, Early Medieval India, Longsman, 2008. Raghunath Rao, the Indian Heritage and Culture, Sterling Publications. So many major and minor dynasty are there, but in brief I have explained in this lecture. Thank you very much for listening my lecture. Thank you one and all.